presentation is from St. Paul's United Methodist Church in Oakland, Maryland.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to St. Paul's United Methodist Church. We're a mission-oriented family on the journey of following Jesus in the Wesleyan tradition. If you're visiting with us today, we want to thank you for being a guest and extend a warm welcome to you. We'd also like to thank those following us on Facebook and listening to us on the radio. Today's broadcast on WMSG 1050 AM and WKTZ 95.9 FM is underwritten by Randy Rodehever and Denise Rinker in loving memory of their mothers, Rosetta Rodehever and Wilda Barefoot. And now, Bob, if you'll lead us in a prelude, thank you. Call to worship based on Psalm 119. Your grace is a lamp for our hearts, O God.
Light our way through the shadows of this world.
When we struggle with questions and doubts,
tell us your stories of hope and grace.
When we are about to wander off into the wilderness,
show us the paths to your peace and your joy.
We have come to worship you, O Lord, for you lead us according to your promise.
Our lips will pour forth your grace.
Faithful God, we come before you today in our brokenness and our dysfunction. We are broken by sin and the effects of sin. When we read your word, every page, every story reveals to us our own brokenness. Yet every page, every story also reveals the amazing presence of the one who longs to embrace us in love, to encourage us in hope, and to lead us in justice. As we worship you this day, we invite you to display your goodness through our brokenness. By your Spirit, empower us to be who you created us to be, a people that reflect your love, hope, and justice. Strengthen us that we might live more fully into the image of your Son, Jesus Christ.
Through whom, with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory is yours, eternal God, now and forever. Amen.
Please stand if you're able as we sing our hymns of worship, Be Thou My Vision, and Something Beautiful. Seated. Let the children come up. We'll have Jesus Loves Me moments.
How's it going, guys?
Good, good, good.
How are you? Excited? I can tell. So, have you ever heard of this book? You might have heard of this other one, Alexandra and the Terrible No Good. What's the name of that book? Terrible No Good, Very Bad Day, I think. Have you ever heard of that? There's this other one that includes the same character. His name is Alexander, who used to be rich last Sunday, and that's the name. So used to be rich means he's not rich anymore, right? So this book was written in 1978. You know how old I was then? I wasn't even born. So this is a little, needs a little updating, because in this book, his grandparents come and they give him a dollar, and he does all these amazing things with a dollar, but we can't do that. So here's my question to you. If you had 10 bucks, what would you do with it? Save it. You're a saver. I'm so proud of you, Lila. You would save it too. What about you?
Save it.
You would? You wouldn't buy anything? What would you buy if you had 10 bucks?
Toys.
I like that answer, right? Toys is what it is. So yeah, so he gets this stuff and he wants to save for an Xbox. He really wants this Xbox. I'm updating this story. And so he wants this video game thing, and so his grandparents come to visit and they give him 10 bucks, and he goes and he buys everything. Like, he thinks about, like, look, there's a candy bar, and he does that, and he he likes money, but he keeps buying things. And he talks about how his brother, they bet on things, and he keeps losing money to his brother. And so it's goodbye, 15 cents there. That's you know, this goes by, goodbye 15 cents. So he spends this whole dollar, like, in no time, and this is, shows you how old this is. Have you ever heard of a telephone booth? Yeah. It's like, yeah, you have these telephone booths, but you know, you used to have to put a quarter in because they didn't have these cell phones, and you had to put a quarter in and call someone.
Matthew.
What?
It's nine.
Yeah, well, back in their time, it was a dime. They're older than I am. Anyway, kids, I tell you, I'm losing you guys, but I'm keeping them. But this was... So he goes through, he loses all this money because he wasn't like you guys. He didn't save his money. And by the end of the book, he doesn't have anything but bus tokens and nothing to spend to keep up for his Xbox or whatever it is he wanted to buy. So if we were to save money and we wanted to get something, we needed to save it. We can't just spend it impulsively on candy bars and toys. Although toys are nice. I like toys. But here's the point. Is in our story today, there is this guy, and there are two brothers. One is named Esau, and the other one is named Jacob. And Esau was the firstborn, and that means that he had all the good rights of, he would inherit all of his family's property and all this stuff. And but he got really hungry one day, and he was just, I'm so hungry, I could eat a horse or something, and he's so hungry that he gives his brother his birthright, because his brother's there cooking some stew, and he's like, hey, I'm so hungry, give me some of your stew. And his brother, who's named Jacob, says, I'll give you the stew if you give me your birthright. Give me all the rights of your inheritance. And guess what Esau did? For 5 minutes of pleasure, for 5 minutes of soup, to satisfy his hunger in that moment, he gave away his whole future. That quick. And it reminds us that we have to think not just about what we need in the moment, but what's the future going to hold? And that's why things like saving are very important. But in this idea here, we also got to think not just about how we lived at this moment, but what is the consequence of that going to be as we go into the future? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you today that you are with us and that you give us so many wonderful gifts. And I pray, Lord, that you would help us not to squander those gifts and not to give them up just for a temporary pleasure, but, Lord, that you would help us to focus on keeping what we have so that we might truly experience your love. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Have a good day.
Please stand if you're able to sing our hymns of praise, Lord, I Need You, followed by Amazing Grace. My chains are gone.
Come, I confess, bowing here. comes my way.
Reading from Genesis 25:19-34. These are the descendants of Isaac, Abraham's son. Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac was 40 years old when he married Rebekah, daughter of Bethuel, the Aramean of Paddan Aram, sister of Laban, the Aramean. Isaac prayed to the Lord for his wife because she was barren. The Lord granted his prayer, and his wife Rebekah conceived. The children struggled together within her, and she said, "If it is to be this way, why do I live?" So she went to inquire of the Lord, and the Lord said to her, "Two nations are in your womb, and two peoples born of you shall be divided. The one shall be stronger than the other. The elder shall serve the younger." When her time to give birth was at hand, there were twins in her womb. The first came out red, all his body like a hairy mantle. So they named him Esau. Afterward, his brother came out with his hand gripping Esau's heel. So he was named Jacob. Isaac was 60 years old when she bore them. When the boys grew up, Esau was a skillful hunter, a man of the field, while Jacob was a quiet man living in tents. Isaac loved Esau because he was fond of game, but Rebekah loved Jacob. Once, when Jacob was cooking his stew, Esau came in from the field, and he was famished. Esau said to Jacob, "Let me eat some of that red stuff, for I am famished." Therefore, he was called Edom. Jacob said, "First, sell me your birthright." Esau said, "I'm about to die. Of what use is a birthright to me?" Jacob said, "Swear to me first." So he swore to him and sold his birthright to Jacob. Then Jacob gave Esau bread and lentil stew, and he ate and drank and rose and went his way. Thus, Esau despised his birthright. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Harry. Appreciate you serving his letters today. During the children's moment, there were a couple people who did answer this question about what you would do if you get $10. Keith said he would give it to the poor. Linda said she'd give it to a single mom that lost her job. And Tom Shelton said he would try to do something good with it. But hey, we have a lot of altruistic people out there. Not like me, I would just probably blow the $10, right? But it's great to see you this morning, and a lot of people have been asking, you know, is the title of the sermon about anything to do with Melissa's birth? Not her birth, but giving birth. And the answer is no. It just happens to be the title of the sermon this morning, and it's a story about twins, so that's what it is. So we're not having twins, just to clarify. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that as we gather together in your name, that you are here in our midst. And we ask, Lord, that you would be with us and help us to understand your word, that we might apply it to our lives and be the disciples you're calling us to be. In Jesus' name, amen. Speaking of twins, though, Bob knows a little bit about twins, so he just had some twins earlier this fall, right? Good news. But do you remember the 1988 movie Twins? Oh, yeah. The plot concerns twin brothers. A group of scientists had set out to develop the perfect man, but in the course of manipulating his genes in the prenatal stage, they accidentally developed another brother. And the perfect man, his name is Julius. He's raised by philosophers. He's so smart, and he grows into athletic proportions. But the other brother, the accident, is named Vincent. And he developed from the leftovers, and he's placed into an orphanage and becomes a lowlife. Do you remember who played those roles? The perfect brother was played by Arnold Schwarzenegger. That's right, Arnold. And the accidental brother was played by Danny DeVito. So even if you know nothing about the movie, you know, the mental picture of those two guys standing side by side as twins is kind of funny. So in Genesis 25, we encounter twins who, like Arnold and Danny, were very different. And the chapter moves quickly. If you lift your eyes from the page, you might just miss a few decades, because in less than 15 verses, Jacob and Esau go from zygotes to teenagers. And yet, not much changes in those verses or in those years. Jacob and Esau are vastly different creatures in the womb, and they are vastly different creatures outside the womb. The story begins before the twins were born. It begins with their parents, Isaac and Rebekah. Isaac married Rebekah, the text tells us, when he was 40 years old. But then this act is noted. Isaac prayed to the Lord for his wife because she was barren. In Isaac's day, the worst thing that could happen to a woman was for her to be childless. Childlessness was taken as a sign that you were outside of God's favor during those times. So Rebecca's inability to give birth presented a problem just because of that, but there was a further difficulty. Because you see, Isaac was the child of promise. Isaac's father, Abraham, had received God's promise that his seed would become a great nation. God said, I will make your offspring as numerous as the stars of heaven, as the sand that is on the seashore. How could that happen if Isaac and Rebekah did not have children? The promise would end with that generation. But the text matter-of-factly states, Isaac prayed for his wife, and the Lord granted his prayer. Now, it makes it seem so easy. Isaac just prayed, and automatically it happened. But what the text leaves unsaid is how much time elapsed between this prayer and the answer. Verse 20 indicates that Isaac was 40 years old when he married Rebekah. But did you hear how old Isaac was when the kids were born? He was 60 years old when Rebekah bore children. We could quite easily miss this textual detail, and yet this detail indicates a 20-year span of time. Isaac prayed, and God answered. 20 years later, 20 years of barrenness, 20 years of failure, 20 years of frustration, 20 years of shame. But in this gap of 20 years, we see an impressive example of the power of prayer. How easy it is to become frustrated. How easy it is to feel like God doesn't hear our prayers. We get frustrated if God doesn't answer in the next day or the next week. Few of us have the patience to wait on God for 20 years. But in two decades of deep anguish, Isaac prays. He prayed because he believed that God is the one who answers prayers. God is the one who opens up the wombs of barren women. God is the one who gives life. Does it seem like God isn't answering your prayer? Are you ready to give up? Well, let Isaac's example of persistence in prayer encourage you this morning. Well, following 20 years of waiting, we can only imagine Rebecca's elation when she finally becomes pregnant. But the joy is short-lived, because once she becomes pregnant, she's overcome by tumultuous tremors within her womb. It's like there's a WWF wrestling match going on inside of her. So severe is the pain that it throws her sensibilities over the edge, and she wonders if she'll even be able to go on living. Her anguished cry is so painful that she can't even complete her thought. Literally, she says, if this be so, then why am I? And then the text kind of just trails off. Translators usually fill in the gap using phrases like, why do I exist? Or why do I go on living? The pain was so terrible that Rebecca thought she would die. Isaac had prayed for fertility, and now Rebecca prays for understanding. And God answers her request, and God gives her an oracle. But God's words are disturbing. The Lord says to her this, two nations are in your womb, and two peoples will be separated from your body. One people shall be stronger than the other, and the older shall serve the younger. The first explanation Rebecca hears concerning her inner turmoil is the word two. They're going to have twins. Isaac had prayed for a child, and he will receive two times more than what he asked for. The Lord then details the destiny of these two boys. First, we learn that the two boys will lead two nations. But then the next line adds a note about a conflict so intense that it will force a separation right from birth. In other words, these children inside of you, God says, are going to battle throughout their lives. And their first battlefield is your womb, Rebecca. And then God tells Rebecca that the two boys will differ in strength. But there's a surprising twist that God ends with when he says the older will serve the younger. The firstborn in the ancient world was granted certain rights and privileges. The leadership and inheritance rights were carefully managed from one generation to the next, and the firstborn child would always receive a double portion of the inheritance. But now God says that he is going to totally subvert that order. God's going to overturn the entire social structure of the day, and he makes no apologies for the disruption that it will cause. But maybe we shouldn't be surprised. Maybe we shouldn't be surprised because, after all, the unexpected ascendancy of the youngest son is a common pattern in the Bible. It's Isaac rather than his half-brother Ishmael who remains the focus of the promise to Abraham. It will be Jacob's son of his old age, Joseph, who sees his dreams fulfilled when his older brothers bow down to him in Egypt. David, the youngest of all of Jesse's sons, is anointed king by Samuel. When his older brothers cower in fear, the boy David emerges as the amazing victor over the Philistine giant Goliath. These and many similar stories of the youngest rising to prominence contradict the expectation, laws, and conventions of society. The weak and the marginal become the surprising means through which God works in Israel and in the world. In God's kingdom, our destiny is not shaped by the privileges the world confers. Our destiny is given to us by God's promise. And God often aligns himself with the insignificant and the disenfranchised. Well, after this incident in which Rebecca receives notice that two babies are struggling inside of her, the story fast forwards to the birth of the twins. As early as their birth, their differences are painted in bold colors. The first son comes out red in color, and he's covered from head to toe with hair. And so they name him Esau, which means hairy. That's right. There's my son, Harry. The second son comes out grabbing the heel of the first, and so they name him Jacob, which means heel grabber. If there's any doubt in Rebecca's mind about the truth of the oracle she received, it's removed at birth, because Jacob has already been fighting for the best starting position, but Jacob loses the prenatal race. From the birth narrative, the narrator moves quickly to show how great the divide between these two twins became in adulthood. Reading between the line in Genesis, you get the impression that Esau was just not the sharpest knife in the drawer, if you know what I mean. One commentator compared him to the character of Hoss on the old Bonanza TV series. He says he had a good heart and was as sweet enough as a person, but, well, the gap-toothed grin and vaguely befuddled look in his eyes told you that he was a guy easy to gang up on mentally. We're not told. But you also have the feeling that Esau probably didn't have much use for a sissy of a little brother. You see, Jacob was a mama's boy. He was a mama's boy if ever there was one. While Esau and his father sat around swapping hunting stories and belching into the afternoon sun, Jacob would be with his mommy, learning the finer points of dicing vegetables and adding just the right spices to make a delicately balanced stew. For his part, Isaac just didn't know what to make of his younger boy. And for her part, Rebecca could barely deal with the aroma that emanated off of her older kid. And so the family quickly divides into two camps. There's Esau and Isaac on the one side, and Rebecca and Jacob on the other. And both camps, they maintained a respectable distance until one day Jacob was cooking some stew. Some stew that he'd probably learned to make under his mother's tutelage. And Esau, he'd been out in the fields hunting. He's been out there all day, and he comes home exhausted. And he grunts, caveman style, "Give me some of that red stuff." Here's the opportunity that Jacob had been waiting for. He has something that Esau desperately wants, but Jacob's not going to give it without exacting a heavy price. Unlike the impetuous Esau, Jacob's words are carefully weighed and calculated. And he says, "Okay, Esau, I'll give you some of that red stuff, some of my stew. But first, sell me your birthright. Sell me your birthright." Remember, the firstborn's birthright meant that he would receive a double inheritance. If there were two sons, the firstborn would get two-thirds of the inheritance. The second son, only one-third. The birthright is Esau's entire future. Without it, in fact, he has no future. He will have no leadership in the community, no ownership of the land, no part of the promise that was given to his grandfather Abraham. All of that was tied up in the birthright. Just like I said in the children's moment, "I'm so hungry I could eat a horse." We say that sometimes. Esau says, "What does it matter about the birthright? I'm so hungry I could die." Esau is so focused on the present moment that he fails to see the bigger future picture. Momentary pleasure took precedence over future reward. But Jacob, he wants to be certain. He wants to be certain that his brother is as boneheaded as he appears to be. And so he says, "Swear to me right now, Esau." And so, in other words, seal the deal. Give me your ironclad vocal announcement that you swear that the birthright is no longer yours to employ. This is like the ancient equivalent of a notary public.
And so Esau swears. And immediately, in this kind of comic scene of sloppy gorging, the man of the hunt, Esau, ate, drank, rose, and left, wordlessly despising his birthright and belching with satisfaction as his future is handed unceremoniously to his wily brother. That's right. I always think of Jacob. Jacob's like, you know, the loan shark, a used car salesman, a bookie in a cheap suit. He's not the kind of guy that I would trust. But Esau is duped, and he's trussed up by his own appetites, used by his brother, who silently twirls his mustache and grins with a very satisfied grin. Ah, well, that stew was good. It was great and all. It settled Esau's rumbling tummy, but old Esau had just traded away a really wonderful thing for what would forever after be referred to as a mess of pottage, as the King James Version puts it. He threw away his birthright for 5 minutes of pleasure, but Esau goes off, seeming not to realize what he's done. Jacob has gotten his birthright, and Esau doesn't even know what hit him. So there you have it. The chosen family, right? There's sibling rivalry from the beginning. There's favoritism by the parents. There's self-centeredness. There's trickery by the children. Neither Jacob nor Esau is particularly likable. You talk about a messed up, dysfunctional family. If ever there was one, here it is. But if you're like me, that's precisely where I identify with this story. I identify with the dysfunctionality of it all. You know, sometimes I feel like we think we have to project to the world and at least to our neighbors that our family, that our home, that our lives are normal, that everything's okay, that it's all fine. But this story reminds us that it doesn't have to be fine. Things can be awful and embarrassingly dysfunctional. And guess what? Even in the midst of dysfunctionality, God can still move. God can still do great things. At the heart of the story of Jacob, at the heart of the whole of the history in the book of Genesis, is the truth that God does things through the lives of the strangest and the most awkward of people. And I say amen to that. When God looked out over the whole world to find the people that he would call his own, the people that he would bless with the privileges of being a blessing to the whole world, he chose what often looks like the B team, what looks like the replacements, the ones who didn't even have the illusion of having their act together. God chose people. Well, he chose people like us. The good news is that we don't have to be perfect. The good news is that we don't have to have everything figured out and in flawless order before God can visit us and bless us. In fact, God can work through us so that we can be a blessing to the whole world, because that's what God did for wily Jacob. It's good to know. It's good to know that God does not reject us out of hand on account of our weaknesses, nor does God find it impossible to accomplish his purposes through us just because we're not yet perfected saints. God's plans can and do go forward in this messed up, broken, often dysfunctional world of ours. And for most of us, at least those of us who are able to honestly assess our lives and families and our own hearts and the world around us, that fact alone is worthy of a hearty hallelujah or two. There's an ancient Portuguese proverb. It says, God writes straight with crooked lines. God writes straight with crooked lines. If God can work in the household of Isaac, Rebekah, Esau, and Jacob, then my goodness, friends, there's no doubt that God can work with us too. Amen. Lord, we thank you for this good news today. We thank you for the story of Esau and Jacob and Isaac and Rebekah. And Lord, we see so much dysfunction and so much that is crazy about this family. And we're like, what do we do with this? But Lord, even through all the dysfunction and the favoritism and the sibling rivalry and all of the challenges that were here in the midst of this story, you were at work to bring about your plans and your purposes and the fulfillment of your promises. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to, when we look at our lives and we assess them, and often we look around and we see what a mess they are, and we see the dysfunctionality of our lives, of our families, of our world, and we wonder, God, can you work in the midst of this? Oh, God, when we read the Old Testament, we see again and again how you take people that are broken, how you take people that are dysfunctional, and you make something beautiful out of their lives, and you bring about their good and your glory. And, Lord, we thank you for that good news today. And I pray, Lord, that amidst the brokenness that individuals here might be facing and individuals that are listening on the radio and over Facebook this morning, that, Lord, you would speak into their brokenness and let them know that you can take that brokenness and you can shape it into a beautiful purpose. We ask, God, that you'd fill us with this good news and assurance today. In Jesus' name, amen. Our hymn of response today is Come Ye Sinners, Poor and Needy, hymn number 340 in the hymnal. As we sing, I invite you to come to the altars this morning. God's here to meet you, to bring whatever pain you might be experiencing. If you just want to take a moment to praise him for the fact that he uses us, won't you come today as we sing together? Come, ye sinners, poor and needy. Time, do you have any joys or concerns, things that we can rejoice with you about or pray with you about this morning? Have a few on Facebook today. Let's see. Someone early on. Janet Stevens would like us to keep her in prayer and also pray for Jim Roche. And then
Tammy Hart has several unspoken requests, so we'll lift those up this morning. Other concerns?
Yes, Matthew.
Yeah.
My brother Milton, who suffers with multiple personality disorder.
Sure, we'll pray for Milton and keep him in our prayers. I want to pray for several individuals that have lost loved ones and lift them up. Pray for the Uphold family. I had a funeral service for them yesterday. Keep Bill Grant's family in prayer. He lost his sister-in-law, Debbie, who was Bowie's wife. And Lori and Bill traveled to Indiana for the funeral service there yesterday. Pray for Mike Saturday, who lost his mother this week. And your friends, Jen and Ed, we'll pray for them and keep them in their prayers. We had Becky Fallon. I want to pray for her. She continues to recover. Pray for Robert Hodges and Kim Hodges. Keep them in prayer. Anything else we can lift up? Yeah, Terry.
Amy Stoyer and her caregivers.
Sure. Pray for Amy and her caregivers as... she also recently lost her mom, I know, and going through that and other challenges that she faces on a daily basis. So pray for Amy and those providing care. Anything else we can lift up today?
Yes, Keith.
We should keep those in prayer that are going to battle another hurricane.
Okay, those that might be facing another hurricane, we'll pray for that. And then... Craig Grenier is asking prayer for his father, who's having surgery. And Gina Thomas is asking prayer for her father, who's in the hospital as well. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we are thankful. We're thankful that as we gather together, your presence is with us. We thank you that you are a God, Lord, who works in wonderful and marvelous ways. And we give you thanks for your grace today. And Lord, we look around the world and we see all the ways in which you continue to be at work, and our hearts are filled with gratitude. Even in the midst of brokenness and even in the midst of dysfunction, you are still at work, and we thank you for that. We thank you, Lord, for the seasons. We thank you that as we are in this change of seasons and we still are seeing some of the beauty of fall, and we see the leaves changing and coming off the trees, we're thankful that you're with us and you are faithful in every season of our lives. Lord, we are also rejoicing for the ideas of how we can celebrate, Lord, milestones for those that are celebrating birthdays and anniversaries and other achievements. We just rejoice with them today. We're thankful as well, Lord, that you're with us as we face physical challenges and that you're the God who heals and encourages and strengthens us. And so, Lord, we lift up so many today that need prayer. And we ask that you would give them, Lord, the touch that they need in their lives. We lift up Becky Fallon, Lord. Continue to be with her as she prepares to go to the surgeon and to look at next steps. We pray for Dan Beckman, Lord. We ask that you would strengthen him and be with him and encourage Brenda today as well. Lord, we lift up Tammy and her needs. We ask that you would minister to her in the midst of all of those unspoken requests today. Lord, for Janet Stevens, we ask for your healing touch. For Jim Roche, Lord, we put him in your hands and your care. For Robert Hodges, I pray that you would strengthen him. For Kim Hodges, that you would help her and give her your healing touch and help them to have answers for the situations that she's facing. Lord, we lift up Amy Stoyer. We pray that you would strengthen her. And Lord, give the strength to her caregivers as well. And Lord, we just ask that you would encourage her heart today. For Milton, Lord, we pray that you would comfort and speak your love over him today. Let him know that you are there. And Lord, we ask for your healing power to be at work in his life. Lord, for Craig's father, as he's recovering from surgery, we ask that you would continue to be with him. For Jim Thomas, Gina's father, as he's been in the hospital, we ask that you would complete the healing. And we thank you, Lord, that he's out of ICU and doing some better. We lift up and pray for strength, Lord, for the Chalkleys, and we ask that you would encourage them today.
Lord, we lift up as well those that are dealing and facing the loss of loved ones as they deal with grief and that loss. I pray that you would come and be the good shepherd, that you would comfort them. We lift up the Grants today, and we lift up the Saturday family and the Uphold family. We continue to pray for Barbara Johnson, that you would encourage her. And for so many, Lord, that are going through times of grief, we ask that you, the God of all comfort, would be with them. God, we pray for the situations in our world as we look around and we see conflicts, especially in places like the Ukraine, and we ask that you would bring peace into the midst of that conflict. We pray, Lord, for those that are facing hurricanes and other natural disasters, that you would keep them safe, Lord. And Lord, we pray for our country. We lift up our leaders, and we ask that you would give them the wisdom that they need to make decisions for justice and for righteousness. And Lord, we pray for the Church of Jesus Christ. You have called us to be a community that makes disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. And I pray, Lord, that we would be faithful to that work, that you would empower us for that work here in Oakland, and that it would impact this community and indeed impact the world. And we thank you, Lord, that the body of Christ, it's not just this body here, but it is all those who proclaim the name of Jesus, that as we lift up your name, Lord, regardless of denomination, I pray that your kingdom might go forward and that disciples would be made for your honor and for your glory. Empower us by your Holy Spirit, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Some announcements today. We want to, first of all, thank Randy Rodehever and Denise Rinker once again for underwriting our radio broadcast in loving memory of their mothers, Rosetta Rodehever and Wilda Barefoot. And thank Randy and Denise for their support of the radio broadcast. Also pray for them. They've been in Florida and are dealing with cleanup from Hurricane Ian that they had at their property there. Today is Undie Sunday. John told me that he left his underwear at the door. So I don't know, Betty, how you're going to deal with that. But yes, if you were able to bring your underwear in, that would be greatly appreciated. We thank you for your donations that go forth. If you forgot today, these help with our conference missions projects. This is often a need that people don't think about when families are going through difficult times or disasters or other challenges. You can bring those in through Tuesday. Our district superintendent will be taking them Tuesday evening at our charge conference. So thank you for your support of Undie Sunday. Soup Cell is, today is probably the last day, so there is a sign-up sheet downstairs. There's some of them have been sold out, but there are still a few available. And so if you go down after the service in the fellowship hall window, there's a sheet that has the remaining soups available. And if you'd sign up today, that soup will be available next Sunday before and after the morning worship services. So we invite you to pick that up. And if you want to place an order tomorrow, is that the deadline, Sue? Yeah, so tomorrow call the church office or Sue if you'd like to order. All Saints Sunday is coming up, November 6th, the first Sunday in November. That's an opportunity when we remember the communion of saints and all those who've gone to their eternal reward, and we especially remember those who've passed away within this past year, since November 1st of last year. So if you have the names of individuals in your family or connected to the St. Paul's Church family that you would like us to remember during that time, please give us their name, date of birth, date of death, and a photo if you have it. And submit that to the church office by November 2nd. Our Bible study continues on Thursday on the Gospel of Mark, so that's at 7 p.m. We always invite you to join us for that. The Cooperative Parish Choir is preparing for their Christmas cantata, and you're welcome to join them as they sing on Wednesday nights here at 7, and then they'll be sharing the cantata on December 4th, the first Sunday in December. Tuesday, as I mentioned a moment ago, is our charge conference. That's at 5:15 here in the sanctuary on Tuesday evening. Our district superintendent will be here as we receive reports, approve officers, and do the business of the church for the coming year. We also have our pennies for mission this month, which is Operation Christmas Child. And so if you can donate to that, you can write Operation Christmas Child or pennies for mission on your check or envelope. And that will help us to get the gifts that we need to fill the boxes and the shipping of the boxes. There's a short video there, Keith, I think, that has highlights some of the work.
When you pack a shoebox full of gifts for Operation Christmas Child, your love is limitless. You never know where that shoebox will go or how it will get there or who will celebrate its arrival, but God does. Your shoebox could dare a child to dream. It could heal a broken heart. It could change a child's life forever. Give a gift of limitless love.
So thank you for your support of Operation Christmas Child and for those who lead that project. We appreciate that. And don't forget, you can write that on your checker envelope and we'll make sure that gets designated for our pennies for mission for this month of October. Any other announcements you'd like to make this morning? All right, if not, would you please take a moment to share the love of Christ with those who are gathered around you today? And we are thankful for all of you, your presence among us. It's always great to see each one of you. You're an important part of the body of Christ, and we're thankful for you. We're thankful for those who have joined us on the radio and online this morning as well. And thank you for your generous support of the work and ministry of St. Paul's. The offering plate is there on the way in and out of the sanctuary. You can also give online or on the link on Facebook. Or if you're listening on the radio today, our address is 318 East Oak Street, Oakland, Maryland, 21550, 318 East Oak Street, Oakland, Maryland, 21550. Let's join together in our prayer of thanksgiving. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. O God of Jacob, author and giver of all good things, we thank you for all your mercies and for your loving care. We bless you for the gift of life, for your protection round about us, for your guiding hand upon us, and for accepting us as your beloved children. Most of all, we thank you for the saving knowledge of your Son, our Savior, for the living presence of your Spirit, the Comforter, and for your church, the body of Christ. Teach us to render to you all that we have and all that we are, that we praise you not only with our lips, but with our lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Now, let's join together in the prayer that Jesus taught us. Let's pray with the confidence of the beloved children of God. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you for all those that are here today and for your help. Bob, always thankful when you're with us. Appreciate your help on the organ today. Thank you, Keith and Sharon. Thankful for you. Thank you, Harry, for serving as liturgist and for Walt back there. We had some great technical difficulties right before the service, and so I was back in there trying to figure it out. But I think it worked, so that's good. That's good. Our closing hymn is number 380. There is within my heart a melody. Let's stand and sing it together. Oh. Today we have heard the good news that even though we are broken, even though we are dysfunctional, God can still work with us and in us to bring about our good and His glory. And we go forth today to share the good news of Christ's love in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Presentation came from St. Paul's United Methodist Church in Oakland, Maryland.